All right. Now, last week I shifted away from the new atheist's fundamental charge that the claims of Christianity are groundless fantasies, beliefs for which there's absolutely no supporting evidence. I shifted away from that to other accusations that the new atheists level against the Christian faith. And we first looked at the problem of evil that they have glommed onto and assert against the claims of Christianity. And I explained why the existence of evil in the world is not logically incompatible with the existence of the God of the Bible. And we're now looking at the new atheist claim that the God of Scripture is a moral monster. As I said, the real claim seems to be, what's really behind this? It seems to be that the God of Scripture, that if he exists, which of course the atheists deny, but they say, look, if he exists, he's not worthy of being worshipped because he's immoral. That seems to be the gist of what they're saying. Now, the new atheists, they bring a number of specific charges against God in this regard, under this larger category of God is a moral monster, or God is immoral. They bring a number of specific charges, and last week I explained why, contrary to their claims, God is not prideful, narcissistic, and vain. And I explained why his jealousy and his anger at spiritual infidelity, why they are not immoral. And when we ended, I was addressing the atheist charge that God is a child abuser. And that seems to orbit around two specific claims. It focuses on the cases of Abraham and Isaac and the crucifixion of the Lord Jesus. And we looked at Abraham and Isaac last week. So I want to pick back up with Dawkins's claim that Jesus' crucifixion was divine child abuse. Well, Jesus' crucifixion was not divine child abuse. It was not a case of something that was being forced on the one and only Son. As the philosopher Paul Copen remarks, he says, we have no passive victim here. Jesus' death on the cross was part of the predetermined plan of the triune God, Father, Son, and Spirit. God is involved in this whole redemption effort. It's not like we're going to plot something against the Son and then we're going to impose something on the Son. That's not the case at all. It says each one suffered in this reconciling work. In weakness, Jesus actually conquered sin and the powers of darkness. So this idea that God is a divine child abuser, Abraham, Isaac, that doesn't work. The notion that the Lord Jesus Christ was somehow abused is wrong, but that doesn't stop them from saying it. Now they also claim, the new atheists, they make the charge that the death penalty in the Old Testament that God administers or commands for certain offenses, that the death penalty there is immoral. They condemn God for prescribing in the Mosaic law the death penalty for certain offenses. They claim that this shows God is cruel and unjust. Just look at the death penalty for these, you know, trivial things or whatever, and that God, that shows that he's cruel and unjust. And their favorites, the ones they like to pick out, include the death penalty for sexual immorality in Deuteronomy 22:21, adultery, Leviticus 20:10, blasphemy, Leviticus 24:10-14, cursing father and mother, Leviticus chapter 20, verse 9, being an incorrigibly rebellious son in Deuteronomy 21:18-21, and working on the Sabbath in Exodus 35:2. Those are the ones they gravitate towards. Say, look, you see, God is cruel and unjust because, look, he prescribes the death penalty for these particular offenses. Well, putting aside the fact that the Mosaic law was far more lenient than other ancient Near Eastern laws, that's a fact. But let's put that fact aside. How do these atheists know? How do they know that it's cruel and unjust for God to prescribe these penalties? What are they looking at? To say, no, I can make the judgment that it's cruel and unjust for the omnipotent, omniscient God to prescribe the death penalty for these certain actions, these acts of disobedience. How can they judge whether it's wrong for God to prescribe a certain penalty for acts of disobedience in the theocracy of Israel, the nation that he was using as a special vehicle to bring his blessings to the world? Who is in a position to make that call? Only God is in a position to know all the factors, all the implications, all the consequences that need to be taken into account in the context of ancient Israel and the work that he was doing with ancient Israel to understand what is a proper and necessary penalty for particular acts of rebellion. You see, you keep seeing the same idea that crops up in how they want to view the problem of evil. They're not in a position to make the judgments. Only God is in that position. Let me read to you a comment by the philosopher Paul Chamberlain. He says, "The serious question then is whether God might have known that on certain occasions, harsh actions, the kind we all puzzle over, were necessary in order for Israel to remain an effective vehicle for expressing and living out this message of good news to the world. For example, could God have known that unless certain penalties were enacted, penalties Dawkins finds so unreasonable, the people of Israel would have been drawn into practices that would have made them ineffective as communicators of God's message of love and forgiveness to the world? After all, they certainly showed tendencies to wander. It just seems to me that it's a chutzpah for somebody to sit in judgment of God and say, listen, God, you got no business setting the death penalty for that offense. I'm going, how are you making that decision? Do you know what God is doing? It's like, where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth? Do you know what God is doing? Do you know the consequences of his having a different penalty? Who are you in a position to make that judgment? And yet they just pontificate. Oh, no. Yeah, no, God was immoral in doing that. Well, thank you, God Richard. But you see that there are reasons and can be reasons. And here you see one, that God is doing something. Chamberlain hypothesized. He says, could it be that if God didn't enact these particular penalties, that the consequences of that would have been detrimental, would have led Israel away from the purpose for which God created them? Well, I would say certainly you couldn't say that's impossible. But even if we couldn't see a justification, there he gives us a possible justification. But even if we couldn't see the justification for a particular penalty, a justification that satisfies us, that wouldn't prove that no justification exists. Again, it's just like on the question of the problem of evil. Because we can't see something doesn't mean that it doesn't exist. It could be that our limited knowledge and our limited perspective is keeping us from seeing the morally sufficient reason we could see if we were omniscient. If we were all-knowing, well, then maybe we'll go, oh, I get it now, I see. Right? Let me read you another comment from Chamberlain. He says, we read of certain puzzling, this is a few pages later. He says, we read of certain puzzling things God did, and we sometimes wonder what good reasons he could possibly have for doing them. Again, our lack of knowledge on this point in no way proves he had no good purpose for these actions, especially given the fact that he is a God who acts with good purposes throughout the Old Testament. Nor is this simply a convenient way out of a difficult problem. It is, in fact, a requirement for anyone wishing to prove God acted unjustly. When it comes to judging the morality of particular actions, it is one thing for us to know God carried out a particular action, but an entirely different matter to know that this action, however puzzling or even troubling, is immoral or unjust. To know that, one would need to know that he carried it out without a good, morally sufficient reason. You see, that's the kicker on this. You are sitting in judgment of an omniscient God and declaring it is impossible for you to have a morally sufficient reason for these things. How do you know that? I can see you saying, you know, well, this troubles me because I can't perceive a more. Okay, that's a different question. That's fine. But don't go jump into the idea, therefore there cannot be one, and therefore God doesn't exist, or he's immoral. You make it a big leap there. You make it a very big leap, and as Chamberlain suggests, the possibility that God had a morally sufficient reason for the penalties that he imposed in Israel, it becomes highly plausible. The possibility that he had a morally sufficient reason becomes highly plausible when we see the love, the compassion, the benevolence, the mercy from God that runs throughout the Old Testament. You can't judge these things in a vacuum. You've got something here, you say, well, this troubles me and I can't readily perceive a morally sufficient reason. Well, say, okay, when you make that judgment, before you leap to the judgment that God doesn't have a morally sufficient reason, is therefore immoral, why don't you look at what you can see of who he is? Why don't you look at his mercy and love and goodness and benevolence and all of that? And then in that context, where's the smart money? The smart money, well, then you better believe that he's got a morally sufficient good reason for this. Why not judge it in the context of what we can see elsewhere? And I think that's an important thing, and that's something that these people don't like to do. Mainly because they can bag people who haven't thought about these things with this kind of stuff, you see. They just throw it up and say, oh, I don't know. That's why we need to think about it. That's why I hope that what I'm saying to you will be helpful to you. Now, in addition, it's quite possible, we're talking about these the death penalty. It says, show that God is cruel and unjust. I've just gone through why. No, it doesn't show that. Because God may have a reason for having the death penalty. One seems quite likely reason is that somehow setting the penalties differently would interfere with what he's doing in creating the nation of Israel through whom he's going to bring the Messiah. But even if one can't figure out something like that and say, well, okay, I don't know about that. And even if one is still in the dark, you can't jump to the idea that God has no morally sufficient reason and is therefore immoral in doing these things. Okay, beyond that, all right, it's quite possible that with the exception of premeditated murder, that with that exception, perpetrators of capital crimes under the Mosaic law could have their death sentences commuted by offering a ransom or a substitute. Let me first show you Numbers 35. It says, if anyone kills a person, the murderer shall be put to death on the evidence of witnesses. But no person shall be put to death on the testimony of one witness. Moreover, you shall accept no ransom for the life of a murderer who is guilty of death, but he shall be put to death. And you shall accept no ransom for him who has fled to his city of refuge, that he may return to dwell in the land before the death of the high priest. So from this text, many people see in here an implication that, okay, he spells out that in the case of murder, premeditated murder, no ransom or substitute may be accepted. Doesn't that imply then that in the other cases it may be? Okay, that in the other cases it may be. Let me read to you what Paul Copin says. Walter Kaiser is a very well-known Old Testament scholar. Walter Kaiser points out the general observation of Old Testament scholars. There were some 16 crimes that called for the death penalty in the Old Testament. Only in the case of premeditated murder did the text say that the officials in Israel were forbidden to take a ransom or substitute. This has widely been interpreted to imply that in all other 15 cases, the judges could commute the crimes deserving capital punishment by designating a ransom or substitute. In that case, the death penalty served to mark the seriousness of the crime. One could cite other scholars in addition to Walter Kaiser, such as Raymond Westbrook, Jacob Finkelstein, and Joseph Sprinkle, all well-known Old Testament guys, who readily concur with this assessment. So if we take the severe Old Testament punishments literally, which maybe we should, Okay, that may be the right way to go. He says, we observe that the Mosaic law is far less strict than other ancient Near Eastern law codes. So even if we say, look, ignore the possibility, ignore the implication here from Deuteronomy 35, and say, well, okay, I don't think that means then that you can in the other situations take a ransom or a substitute. Ignoring that possibility is still far less strict, and you have all that I've said about this up to this point. But he says, if on the other hand we follow these scholars who take the Old Testament's capital punishment laws as allowing for a ransom payment instead, with the exception of premeditated murder, then this opens up a dramatically new perspective on these apparently severe punishments. So I think that's important to keep in mind. First, I don't think without that, that you can indict God. Far, far from it. But I think you have this possibility here that is something that we oftentimes don't consider. And I wanted to talk about a number of other texts, just a couple of them, that don't involve the death penalty, but they oftentimes get brought into this discussion about is God cruel or unjust. And one of those texts is Deuteronomy 25, 11 and 12, which is sometimes seen as prescribing a penalty of mutilation that's all out of proportion to the offense. If you look at Deuteronomy 25, 11 and 12, when men fight with one another, and the wife of the one draws near to rescue her husband from the hand of him who's beating him, and puts out her hand and seizes him by the private parts, then you shall cut off her hand. Your eye shall have no pity. Now, if the text does indeed prescribe the cutting off of the woman's hand, then the offense probably was reaching out and grabbing his private parts so severely as to damage his testicles to preclude him from having children. If that's the penalty, that's probably what is being involved. It is such a severe offense that we say, well, can't have kids. Tremendous thing. You deprive somebody of that, especially in the ancient world, and that is an extreme offense. So that's one possibility. But it's also possible, perhaps even likely, that the penalty that's referred to here refers to the public shaving of the woman's pubic hair. To the public shaving of that, a way of humiliating her that is commensurate with the humiliation of her publicly grabbing a man's private parts. Now you say, that seems like an awful big stretch. But it's not really. See, the form of the verb that's used here, it means normally to clip or to cut or to shave, and the normal word for hand, yad, is not used here. Instead, the word kaf is used, which normally is palm. Okay, but it also can serve for any convex shape. You see, any convex shape, any concave object, this shape, concave, like a woman's groin area. You see, so it normally means to clip, to cut, or to shave, and this word cough, like palm, can be a concave object. And so you wind up with this idea, is this simply a way of saying shaving her publicly? And you say, well, I've never heard of that. Let me give you one person. Christopher Wright, who's a well-known Old Testament scholar, he writes in his commentary on Deuteronomy, he says, the phrase, you shall cut off her hand, may not be meant literally, but may be a euphemism for the female genital region. And then he cites as a parallel how sometimes feet are used euphemistically for the male genital region. Okay, so that's another possibility there. So you have two thoughts on this. These guys are always trying to cast things in the worst light, the most uncharitable light. And so what I want you to look at is to see, is, okay, well, if this is cutting off, then I'm going to assume that the grasping is something more severe than simply touching. Or if it's that, then I'm going to look at this and say, well, maybe it's simply a public humiliation that's commensurate with the humiliation of her grabbing the man's private parts. You say, well, how do you get there? The way I just told you. The word normally means cut, clip, shave. And this can stand for any concave object. There you have it. Okay, so I think, you know, looking at these things, instead of taking what these people try to throw on you at face value and say, oh, look at this, look at this. Every time you dig into some of these things, you find that these guys are creating straw men, and they're creating things that just won't hold up. Well, as I'm sure you know, One of the things that they charge God with immorality is that the command to kill the Canaanites, that God is immoral in that. That's one of the favorite ones that they get on. And they accuse God of indiscriminate killing and genocide in commanding Israel to destroy the Canaanites. For example, in Deuteronomy 20, 16 to 18. And that's no doubt what's behind Dawkins' description of God as a, quote, bloodthirsty ethnic cleanser, end quote. And as a, quote, racist, infanticidal, genocidal, capriciously malevolent bully, end quote. That's no doubt what's driving those particular remarks of Dawkins. But in the first place, I think it should be noted that the command, God's command to Israel to, quote, utterly destroy, end quote, the Canaanites, it exists among a greater number of commands and descriptions that Israel is to drive out, dispossess, or expel the Canaanites from the land rather than annihilate or exterminate all of them. You can see that, for example, in Exodus 23, 27 to 31. Numbers 21, 32, Numbers 33, 51 to 56, Deuteronomy 7, 17 to 23, and other places. You see this notion of driving them out, expelling them, you see, having them go out in a way that's comparable to Israel's being, to God vomits them out of the land, expels them, sends them away. So you have a greater number of commands and descriptions involving that. You see, there was no command to pursue and hunt down the Canaanites if they fled. So if they had fled, as many of them no doubt did, or if they had joined Israel, as Rahab did, they wouldn't have been killed. They would not have been killed. Those who refused to abandon the land that God had given Israel as part of His unfolding work to redeem His creation, they were to be exterminated. Now, though Joshua chapter 6 through chapter 12, it says in a number of places that absolutely every human in certain cities, young, old, male, female, everything that was breathing, says that they were destroyed. It's possible, okay, just I say possible, that this is hyperbolic. In other words, it's possible that this is standard, stylized war language, comparable to what we see being used in other groups. It's possible this is hyperbolic, standardized war language that would not be intended to be taken literally, to mean absolutely every person that breathed, child, infant, if there were any left. It's possible that that's the case, but would rather be understood that Israel utterly and resoundingly defeated those cities. Paul Copen and Matthew Flanagan, they argue at length for this possibility in their 2014 book, Did God Really Command Genocide? I commend it to you. You go read it. You see what you think about their arguments. But even if one ignores that possibility, so I simply give that to you as a possibility. You can go chew on that and see what you think of it. But even if one ignores the possibility that Joshua employed hyperbolic, stylized war language, these atheists, they simply assume in their criticism again. They simply assume that if they can't see a morally sufficient reason for God's killing all of those who remained in the land, then no such reason exists. Do you see that thread running through everything that they're doing in terms of these criticisms? But why think that? It's not crazy to say, wait a minute, why do you think that? Why do you insist that because you can't perceive, as we sit here now in 21st century American culture, you can't perceive a morally sufficient reason for that? Why do you insist that no such reason exists? It's like an infant insisting that the parents can't have a good reason for sticking him with a needle because he can't understand it. But you're sticking your kids with needles all the time, right? Vaccinations and all this kind of stuff. What's a kid know? Kid knows these people are sadists. They're sticking me with stuff. And you're going, you don't get it. But there'll be a time when you will get it, when you will come to understand more. and then you will then perceive the goodness and rightness of what I'm doing. You see, and I think that's important. Now, given the nature of God revealed in Scripture, most clearly revealed in the sacrificial love that He shows mankind in Jesus Christ. Smart money, again, is on Him having a good and morally sufficient reason for everything that He does. Why, in an ambiguous case, after He's demonstrated Himself this way, after Jesus has died for us, that we would jump back and say, no, I'm going to say that this one who's shown Himself to be this way, I'm going to choose against Him in the ambiguous case. I'm going to make the wrong assumption. I'm going to assume the worst for Him in the ambiguous case. And I'm going to assume He has no reason. And instead of saying, listen, He's omniscient. He's shown Himself to be loving, benevolent, kind, faithful, sacrificial. So in the ambiguous case, I'm going to say, I'm with Him. I'm going to trust that He does have a good reason, even if I can't perceive it. Now, I cannot help but note that many of the atheists denying that God could have a morally sufficient reason for killing innocent children, they are pro-abortion. Ah, you see, I can't help but notice that they're pro-abortion. So they claim falsely, I might add. They claim falsely that it's morally justified to kill babies in the womb for the convenience of the mother, and then they turn around and insist that it's impossible for the omniscient Creator to have a morally sufficient reason for killing innocent children. Didn't you just finish telling me that it's okay to kill babies? You're wrong about that, but at least you're claiming it. And now you turn around and say, though you claim that's morally sufficient, you're going to tell me that an omniscient Creator cannot have a morally sufficient reason? Well, you seem to understand there can be this idea, there can be morally sufficient reasons for that, right? So this is something that is worth, I think, remembering. Now, we're not left totally in the dark in this case regarding God's motivations. We're told that the Canaanites were grossly immoral. They were grossly immoral, engaging in all kinds of sexual immorality and engaging in child sacrifices. And we're told that God waited for centuries. You want a patient God? He waited for centuries before their sin reached the limit where it could no longer be tolerated. You see that, for example, in Genesis 15, 16. Amorites being one of the Canaanite people groups. So God, here they are, they're grossly immoral. God waits for centuries. And then God chose to use the Israelites as His instruments of judgment. See, unlike Sodom and Gomorrah, where He judged it directly. Right? I mean, Sodom and Gomorrah, God just judged it. Well, in this case, God chose to use Israel as His instruments of judgment against the grossly immoral and wicked people of Canaan, who refused to change over centuries. And God uses them to do that, the people of Israel, to execute His judgment. And in conjunction with their execution of the judgment, God establishes them as a special religious nation in that central geographical location, a nation through which He would bring the Messiah to bless all the nations of the world. See, God is not a human being. God is the giver of life, and He has the right to take it in judgment and to take it in fulfillment of His good purposes. So we look at the Canaanites, and so we're not left in the dark here. We say, who are these people? They're grossly wicked and immoral. God is doing something with bringing Israel into this land. He's going to bring the Messiah through them. He's got a long-term big project He's doing. They are to flee and be expelled. Those that don't are to be exterminated, and God has a reason for doing it. That's His judgment on them, in addition to whatever effect they would have on the Israelites living there. And you say, well, look, that works for the people who are morally responsible, but the Canaanite children weren't guilty. Well, that's true, but only God is in a position to know how allowing them to live would have played out in history. Here's what Paul Chamberlain, he says about this. He says, might God have known that unless a particularly violent and unjust civilization was destroyed, those remaining would simply grow up and reinstate the same practices that would again entice Israel away? Could God know that these children, what they'll grow up with the greatest resentment ever, and they will then grow up and lead and attack? No, God can't know that. What? Why? The God I'm talking about is omniscient. What do you mean he can't know that? Why do you say that? All right, so this is something I think it's worth keeping these things in mind. Now, of course, the innocent children who were killed would go to a blessed state. They would go to paradise, and they would be delivered from the culture's moral and religious corruption. So I think that's worth keeping in mind. Now, the new atheists, in addition to this, they like the idea, well, God's immoral in having Israel kill the Canaanites, ignoring the fact that they're to expel them and drive them out. But they also make a great deal about God's regulations regarding slavery. They argue that God's regulations regarding slavery, they were immoral. And I'm here to tell you they're not immoral. But this is the argument. This is the argument that they make. They charge that the Bible condones slavery, and therefore it's immoral. For example, Sam Harris writes in the LA Times in December of 2006, both books, referring to the Bible and the Quran, condone the practice of slavery, and yet every civilized human being now recognizes that slavery is an abomination. And as I mentioned to you before, Hitchens insisted that the Old Testament contains, quote, a warrant for trafficking of humans and for slavery. So they ride this because they recognize our sensitivity, rightly, to the issue of slavery. So they think, see, this is an end where I can undermine people's faith by saying God is pro-slavery, and you understand that's immoral, right? So how can you worship this God? This is what they're doing, you see. This is an attack. This is the ongoing, this is their goal. They're evangelizing, proselytizing, the whole time saying, I'm not a religion. But this is what they're doing. Now, it is not, God's regulations regarding slavery were not immoral. The so-called slavery, I want to look at this in two ways. I want to first talk about the so-called slavery that God permitted among fellow Israelites in the Old Testament. Okay, so first let's talk about what did God permit among the Israelites, within his covenant community. And then we'll look at those outside of that and what God permitted there. Okay, but first, the so-called slavery that was permitted among fellow Israelites in the Old Testament, that was not slavery in the sense that we think of it. It was a voluntary form of debt servitude. It was a way of paying off a debt. Or it was a way to attach oneself to someone else's household to survive poverty and destitution. It was voluntary debt servitude. That's what existed within Israel. Kidnapping, forcibly abducting someone, that meant the death penalty. It meant the death penalty not only for the kidnapper, but for anybody found in possession of the stolen person. You can see that in Exodus chapter 21, verse 16. Well, that obviously eliminates the kind of slavery known in the West. You know, colonial slavery, the slavery known in America where Africans were abducted and sold. And Deuteronomy 24:7 applies that principle and that penalty specifically to slave trading of fellow Israelites. All right, so this idea that somehow you can just go grab somebody and involuntarily bring them into slavery is not right. What we have among the people of Israel is voluntary debt servitude because God had delivered the Israelites. God tells them this. He says, because I delivered the Israelites, delivered the Hebrews from Egyptian slavery, they are not to be made to serve as slaves. I delivered them from slavery. Therefore, they are not to be made to serve as slaves, but as a hired servant or a bound laborer, not a slave. You see Leviticus 25:39-40. If your brother becomes poor beside you and sells himself to you, you shall not make him serve as a slave. He shall be with you as a hired worker and as a sojourner. He shall serve with you until the year of Jubilee. So here you see that they're not to be made slaves. Now the Hebrew word, there are words for both male and female slaves. The Hebrew word that is used, that's translated slave, both male and female, the words are broad enough. Those words are broad enough to cover both slaves and hired servants. So when that word appears in the context of fellow Israelites, when it's applied to Israelites, it is better, as you see that in Exodus 21, verse 2, Exodus 21, verse 7, when that happens, it's better translated servants, as it is in the New English Translation, the NIV, the footnote in the English Standard Version. It's better translated servants because you are not to treat fellow Israelites as slaves, but as bound servants. There's a distinction. And so when you translate it that way and say slaves, then you act, well, they're not acting according to what God says, and you just confuse people. So it's better to have it understood as servants. Let me read to you what Gunther Haas says of Israelites who sold themselves into bond service. This is from the Dictionary of the Old Testament, the Pentateuch. There are a number of dictionaries of the Old Testament, came out in InterVarsity Press over the years, Prophets, Pentateuch, all, you know, numerous volumes. This is from the volume on the Pentateuch. Haas says, they may not be sold as chattel slaves to other masters. Their time of service to fellow Israelites is limited to 6 years. And to resident aliens, if they sell themselves to an alien instead of to an Israelite, resident aliens, it is limited to the Jubilee year. In the latter case, if they sell themselves to an alien, somebody who lives there but is not one of the people of Israel, they may be redeemed by a relative at any time during their servitude. So even though I go into voluntary debt servitude to a non-Israelite within Israel, I can be redeemed at any time. My uncle can come in and say, okay, I'm paying off his debt. He can be redeemed. I want you to see this is different. This is a voluntary form of debt servitude that is just called slavery to make it look as bad as it can be, or as bad as they can make it look. It says, in the latter case, they may be redeemed by a relative at any time during their servitude. Israelites may enter into a condition of permanent servitude only if they choose so because of love for the master and for a slave wife and children. So this is the idea that they have the option. They can say, listen, that's the thing with the awl and the ear and all that. They can say, listen, you know, this is working out well for me. I like this. I want this to be permanent. They can do that, but this isn't slavery. This isn't the way that we understand slavery. They could not be treated harshly. You see that in Leviticus 25, 43, 46, 53. And Deuteronomy 15, 16 makes clear that the arrangement could be so beneficial, as I just mentioned, that they choose to stay in it permanently. So, I mean, that's not, you know, we're thinking of Southern Man, you know, Crosby, Stills, Nash, and Young. I hear bull whips cracking and all that. And so, you know, this is something different. This is something different. The release after 6 years, they were to be released after 6 years. And by the way, when they were released, that release was to be accompanied by the provision of sufficient assets for them to make a new start. So I sell myself to you into debt servitude. It's only for 6 years contract. At the end of 6 years, I'm released, but you don't just send me out the door with nothing. You have to send me out the door with provision of sufficient assets to make a new start. You can see the 6 years in Exodus 21:2. You can see the idea that provision must be supplied in Deuteronomy 15, chapter verses 12 to 18. And in the year of Jubilee, the servant who was released would receive back the inheritance that he'd previously transferred out of economic necessity, so that property would come back to him. You can see that in Leviticus 25, 28. Now, there were various requirements in the Old Testament, by the way, that were intended to help keep people from destitution. There are various requirements to help keep people from poverty, from destitution, so they wouldn't have to enter into this kind of debt servitude. You had safeguards for that. The poor could glean the edge of the fields. And they could pick fruit that was remaining on trees after the harvest. Leviticus 19, 9 and 10. Leviticus 23, 22. Deuteronomy 24, 20 and 21. That was a provision for the poor hoping to keep them out of debt servitude. Israelites were commanded to lend freely to the poor. Deuteronomy 15, 7 and 8, who were not to be charged interest. Exodus 22, 25, Leviticus 25, 36 and 37. The poor could substitute less expensive animals for sacrifice. Why do you think that is? You see, they could sub because they were poor, and the idea was to keep them out of destitution and crushing poverty. And so you can see that in Leviticus 5, 7, and 11. And their debts were to be canceled every 7 years. Deuteronomy 15, 9, and 10. And the intention was that there be no poor among them, Deuteronomy 15, 4. So there are these things built in structurally within the people of Israel to help the poor and to keep them from the kind of destitution that would require them to save themselves and to sell themselves and be into a voluntary debt servitude. Now, the option of this debt servitude, it was a humanitarian function. It is amazing to me that these critics have taken what was a humanitarian function and they've turned it into a thing of immorality. But they do this only for people who don't know anything. This is how they get away with it. And this is what's happening. We just have all this stuff on the internet, blogs and all this stuff. And they just do this stuff for people. You see, it's just out there and the people, and they don't care. They don't care. See, in our society, we mortgage our homes. We mortgage our homes, meaning that we borrow money that we need. And we agree with the lender that if we don't pay it back, he can sell our home to get his money. Right? This is what we do. This is what a mortgage is. And this is considered socially beneficial. Why? Because it encourages the lender to provide money we need by giving him some security so he'll know he's not throwing his money away. So it lubricates the process. And we don't think that's immoral. We think, no, that's a wise policy, because it encourages them to lend money to the people who need it. Well, in that world, Israelites did the same with their labor. They did the same with their labor. You see, when a poor man borrowed money, his or a family member's labor was either the agreed form of repayment. You give me this money and I'll work for you. It was either the agreed form of repayment or it was the security for repayment by other means. I heard that bell. Let me finish this line. All right. In other words, the borrower said, either I will become your bondservant in exchange for this loan, or I will become your bondservant if I fail to pay the loan back by a certain date. That was the transaction, you see. And this facilitated the lending of money to those who needed it. And then you have the other factor, which is it allowed the destitute to associate. They're going to starve to death. It allowed them to connect themselves to somebody else's household so that they could survive. They sell themselves into debt servitude, so they then are fed and clothed and housed and have something there, and then they're provided for in a very harsh economic environment. And we stand back in judgment. He shouldn't do that. We can't even get our stuff going right. And we're sitting there judging God about this? It's insane, but I heard the bell. Thanks.